If Benjamin Britten had one favourite city in the world, it was Venice. He visited it 8 times in his life, normally in the winter. Captivated by its sounds, its light, its history, and its art. It offered the composer respite from his normal frenetic existence.
The plane sort of bounced over Venice when you're going there, and he was looking out, and there was a big smile on his face, and he said, "There it is, Serenissima."
For Britten, Venice had been a place of triumph. In the 1950s, it gave him the premiere of his opera, The Turn of the Screw, just as it had given Verdi the first performances of Rigoletto and La Traviata a century before. But Venice is also famous for disease and decay. It's where Monteverdi and Wagner died and Stravinsky is buried. And in a sense, it was to claim Britten too. The story of Death in Venice by Thomas Mann struck a chord with Britten. He knew what it was to wrestle with serious illness and with demons in his personal life. After all his victories as a young man, he found it tough to keep his footing in the swirling currents of contemporary music. Where was it? Benjamin Britten was a man under pressure, struggling to get his late music down on paper.
Who's playing the block?
People sometimes think that with a number of works now lying behind, one must be bursting with confidence. It is not so at all. I haven't yet achieved the simplicity I should like in my music.
He had the most colossal job to perform in life, and I think he knew it almost from birth. In some way, I think he also knew that his life wasn't going to be a very long one, and he was going to have to get an awful lot into it.
Venice was the setting for Britten's final opera in 1973, which mirrored his own life. He was still in his 50s, but fast running out of options, and all his late music was driven by the shadow of death, his own.
He was a man in a hurry, who knew he had a great gift, who knew he had a lot to offer, and he didn't have all the time in the world.
Benjamin Britten wasn't simply the greatest opera composer produced by the 20th century. He was a gifted conductor and festival organizer, and one of the outstanding pianists of his generation. As a young man, he'd contemplated a career as a piano soloist. He played his own concerto at the proms before the war. But in later years, he confined himself mainly to chamber music and song recitals, notably with his partner, Peter Peers. Even that was hard.
He would have a tumbler of whiskey or brandy, which he'd have a couple of sizable gulps before playing.
Good for him. This is unique. I don't know any other artist. I often tell musicians this who don't know it, and they're shocked, because they would never dare touch alcohol before they go on.
Usually meant several, it seemed like gallons of whiskey backstage before he went on.
Whatever your poison is, I don't know how on earth any of us get out there.
And very often he vomited several times before he went on stage. He was so worried and nervous.
He was in his dressing room and he banged on his window and shouted, "Derry!" And he was going to conduct something, I don't know what. I said, "How are you feeling?" He said, "Terrible." He said, "I could be sick on the spot."
Well, there's no doubt that Henry Purcell was convinced of the truth of the title of his song, "Man is for the Woman Made." But we're going to sing 3 songs to throw some light on this eternal riddle.
But it was terribly difficult for Peter. I remember Peter getting really quite cross with him just before going onto a platform once or twice, saying, "For goodness sake, pull yourself together. How do you expect me to sing when you're in a state like this?"
When I was a bachelor, I lived all alone, and I worked at the weaver's trade, and the only thing I ever
never did wrong was to woo a fair young maid.
But once he got his hands on the keys and was playing, he got his nerves under control. And one might almost say that by the end of a concert, he had quite enjoyed himself. Quite.
If you shut your eyes for a moment and think of Benjamin Britten and sort of conjure him up in front of you, what do you see?
I see a big smile.
A very friendly face.
But some people see a frown.
When he smiled, if he smiled, it was a shy sort of smile.
He could be quite ruthless.
Very sprightly, really.
Quite wiry.
Athletic, even.
Always amazed by his nose. A great long conch.
Fairly heavy jowls later on in life, which made him look a bit ferocious.
Looking extraordinarily healthy all the time, although, of course, we know he wasn't.
At figure five, what man do build, it's just a natural warmth as you go up. Don't let it flower into a sort of Tosca-like sound. Keep it quite hushed. If people can't hear what I say, can you complain? I'll try and support my voice.
Life had been so simple when he was young. His wonderful hymn to the Virgin was tossed off during a day or two in the sick bay at school. Music, it was said, sprang from his fingers when he played the piano, just as it did from his mind when he composed. In the early 1960s, he bestrode the world stage with his great pacifist work, The War Requiem,
Benjamin Britten,
as the world teetered on the brink of nuclear war.
And Meredith Davis.
He'd hit the headlines almost two decades earlier with his first big opera, Peter Grimes, which took post-war London by storm. By his 50th birthday in 1963, he was more celebrated internationally than any previous British composer. But under the pressure of expectation, he withdrew from the spotlight, fighting ill health and brooding over what would be his last hurrah on the operatic stage. A work whose central character, Gustav von Aschenbach, reflects Britten himself, a creative artist in middle age, fretting about his craft as the years slip away.
I can't think of any other opera where a composer kind of sets out his stall so specifically. It's as though Britten wants to get on with this. And when you hear the first few sentences, you realize that he's telling you all about the dilemma, the central dichotomy of his life, and the moment he's at now, facing death. My mind beats on, and no words come, taxing, tiring, unyielding, unproductive. My mind beats on, no sleep restores me.
From the very moment it starts up, that very, very first, that very, very first thing, it's a kind of feeling of sort of febrile, everything being on the edge. Aschenbach is completely unable to cope.
My mind beats on. My mind beats on. And
that's so Britten. That harp tells you we're going to go into an imaginary world soon.
Taxing, tiring.
In early 20th century Munich, Aschenbach worries about his creativity drying up, just as Britten would half a century later.
Unyielding, unproductive.
Very ominous, these songs. Almost immediately, Britten has set up the colours of the palette that he's going to draw on.
No sleep restores me.
That's a self-portrait. He was the most disciplined man, and imagination was the servant of his will.
My mind beats on. My mind beats on. Why am I now at a loss?
Aschenbach, like Britten, has a Puritan approach to life, which will be turned on its head as the opera unfolds.
I reject the words called forth by passion. I suspect the easy judgment of the heart. Now passion itself has left me, and delight in fastidious choice.
He was such an incredible master by the time he wrote Death in Venice that the state of mind of Aschenbach is exactly and perfectly described in that music. And the consequence of that is you can get inside the head of that guy and stay inside the head of that guy from the beginning of the opera to the end.
He was never somebody who had writer's block himself, or if he did, it was something that he'd get over with very quickly. You read so often in his letters or diaries, you know, I'm having a terrible time writing, I can't write a note. And it basically means he'd had a difficult afternoon, because for him, I mean, that was a struggle. But, you know, compared with other composers, I mean, he was extraordinarily fluent.
For some in the musical world, Britten's fluency was not a badge of pride. The new progressives felt his music was too easy, too accessible. He hadn't joined the bandwagon of the avant-garde and still used the time-honored system of tonality, which was supposed to be worn out. Britten himself worried that his powers were on the wane. He commented just before his 50th birthday that he was the last rotting branch of a dying tree.
He told his publisher, Donald Mitchell, that he was forgotten and that he was being left behind. And I think there's something in that.
I don't always follow the new directions, and nor do I always approve of them. Seeking after a new language has become more important than saying what you mean.
He was not in the club, in a sense, in the avant-garde club, and I think that probably did worry him quite a lot.
I think this is a moment of lack of confidence, which I shall outgrow.
I remember people sort of being quite dismissive at Royal College when you talked about Britten or Shostakovich. Those composers, you know, were sort of thought of as a bit old-fashioned.
Understand why one should want to reject the past. If we rejected the past, we should just be making funny noises.
I think he felt a bit out of touch. He was there in Aldborough as a kind of king of Aldborough, living isolated from the town, and I felt he was a bit, he was a bit out of touch with everything, in a way.
Well, I think you put your finger on it, it was Old Hat. And an awful lot of the composers I admired at that time couldn't have any time for it at all. And that's it, particularly foreign composers. I remember meeting Luciano Berio at Dartington, and he was very rude about Britain.
I couldn't be alone. I couldn't work alone. I can only work, really, because of the tradition that I am conscious of behind me. This may be giving myself away. If so, I can't help it. It is a time of change in music now, whether one likes to admit it or not. The old tradition has split.
Britain guarded his national status jealously, but at the same time, he avoided simply repeating his early successes. He did look for new directions, one of them sparked by his new best friend, the Russian cellist Slava Rostropovich. He'd never written for the solo cello before and relished the challenge of stretching the instrument's technique. This music is now a staple of the professional cello repertoire. Then it was a private tease for Rostropovich's virtuosity. But in other ways, it was music of retreat, of withdrawal from the public stage, with its own dark shadows. Britain was often holed up in Suffolk, immersed in the Aldborough Festival. He'd withdrawn from the operatic stage too, with a new form of drama performed in church with just a handful of instruments and without a conductor. He wrote the first of these church parables soon after the War Requiem, and it could hardly have been more different. Curlew River is a stark meditation on mortality and grief, which foreshadows death in Venice in the strange oriental colours of the music. And as in several of his works, notably Death in Venice, it has a boy at its heart.
I remember this bit very well. This is when the madwoman who's been wandering around the place looking for her lost child.
Good people, good people. Where shall I turn? Tell me now. Take me back, take me back. Chain on my soul, let me go. Chain on my soul. Chain on my soul.
The people that she meets on the ferry reveal a story of a little boy who died on a journey across the Curlew River. And she suddenly realizes that the little boy in question was her son, and her son is dead.
This poignant story is set in the Fenland marshes of East Anglia, but clothed in the formal ritual of Japanese no theatre alongside Gregorian plain chant from medieval Christianity. The all-male cast are dressed as monks, who then put on a play within a play.
The stylized gestures of the no actor, they're supposed to conjure a more poetic response from the audience, so that an audience sees something in their mind's eye that is far greater than what's on the stage.
Mm-hmm.
Curly River was the biggest emotional experience I had at all, of all his music. It really touches people's sense of life and death.
The way Britten wrote for the tenor voice of Peter Piers defined Curly River, just as it had in Peter Grimes and would again in Death in Venice. Piers captured Britten's emotional connection with a mother deranged by the loss of her young son.
This is the madwoman praying at the grave of her son. And the flute. It's the call of the curlews.
Britten broke new ground in the way each performer sings or plays the notes at his own speed, only coming together at key moments. Such as when they think they hear the voice of the dead boy's spirit above the tumult.
So they're not sure of what they can really hear.
What it sets out to do is quite extraordinary, and it's one of the most individual works that he ever wrote.
I thought I heard him praying in his grave.
I remember the score arriving, and I looked at it, and I could make absolutely no head or tail of it. I could see the notes, I could sing the notes, but I didn't understand the layout of this part.
The music was of then such difficulty that it required the longest rehearsal period of any opera of the English opera group that I've ever known. We had 5 solid weeks, including all the orchestra.
In fact, I never did learn it beforehand. There was no way I could learn it. We all learned by doing, because we all had to learn the whole piece.
Is it you, my child?
Britten had long since let go of his Christian upbringing. But he was absorbed by the idea of redemption and transfiguration.
He rewrote the end, I think, 6 times, till he was really satisfied with it. He had 6 different versions to rehearse before he finally said, "This is it, I've got it." Curly River was blacked out before it even started by an electrical storm. And the entire audience, full of critics and managements, was sitting there in the church in the dark.
My goodness, the tension that built up was tremendous.
What about Britten himself?
Goodness knows what he was doing.
He was out in the churchyard just bringing everything up. He was in a terrible, terrible state.
We just waited and waited.
And then, during the performance, he and I were leaning against a pillar at the back of the church watching it. And this lightning kept on going off. And he thought, "Oh, God, it's going to happen again. It's going to be blacked out in the middle of the piece. It'll wreck it." And he started getting very upset. Then he discovered there was a light illuminating the big painting behind the altar, which is the other end of the church. And he was leaning against that button, you know, one of those time buttons. So every time he leant on it, the lightning flashed. And he was getting sicker and sicker, poor man.
At the end of Curly River, the boy releases the madwoman from her torment. and at the same time releases an unusual tenderness in Britten's score.
The voice of a little boy singing to his mother, "Go your way in peace, mother. The dead shall rise again."
There was this passionate yearning in him for a child, and I think this came through the whole mother's predicament in that opera. I think it was very personal to him from that point of view.
He had always had something wrong with him.
He had continual problems with one arm.
He was sometimes a martyr to stomach troubles.
He would run a high temperature for a reason nobody quite understood.
We were nursing him along quite a lot of the time.
We thought of it as really being an emotional, mental problem.
We were looking ahead to what the schedule was likely to be, and he said, "Well, I'm going to do this, and I've got a few other pieces to write, and so on, and then I shall be ill." And I said, "What?" And he said, "Oh, I'm always ill after a big piece." But it was such a strange thing to sort of build in your illness into a schedule.
Having Monday lunch with him, and he apologised because it was cold meat. It was yesterday's roast. And he said, I don't really like this at all. I said, "Well, why don't you ask Miss Hudson to do something special?" "Oh," he said, "that's more than my life's worth." And at the same time, she came in and she put down his pills in various orders and said, "Mr. Britten, they're your pills to take this morning."
There was a sort of slightly more haunted, worried look to him. He didn't have that youthful confidence anymore.
He couldn't go for such long walks anymore, and he wasn't playing tennis anymore, and generally speaking, he just wasn't feeling well.
It
the desperate difficulty for him was to keep the world at bay so that he had enough time to compose. And the world seemed to conspire to take him away from that. So he was fighting everybody and everything around him all the time.
He'd had a crisis in his health in his mid-40s when he saw a consultant over his multiple medical problems. He was diagnosed then with a leaking valve in his heart. It was decided not to operate. By 1968, the heart murmur was louder, and he spent several weeks in hospital with a serious heart condition, endocarditis. If anything, this compounded his determination to proceed with Death in Venice, his 17th work for the stage. The complexity of the book, with its high-flown language and ideas, was a challenge for his librettist, Mfanwi Piper. She and Britton batted ideas back and forth in every spare moment and on any scraps of paper that came to hand. On legal advice, Britton never saw Visconti's feature film of Death in Venice, starring Dirk Bogarde, to avoid any risks over copyright, because Britton was set on his subject. The Munich writer Aschenbach travels to Venice, the gateway to the exotic Orient, hoping the change of scene will stimulate him. But the beauty he finds there has a sickness that will in the end destroy him.
Venice was a place that would suffer from disease, cholera, which would wipe people out. So the season would end and the city would suddenly transform into somewhere that was even ominous and frightening. And it is fascinating how a place of great beauty can also become somewhere that is quite chilling.
This dark side of beauty resonated with Britton. He knew he was running serious risks with his health, but the opera came first.
The race was on to get it finished, get it completed, because, of course, the world was waiting for the next Britton opera.
If he had had his heart dealt with a bit earlier, maybe even before he started writing Death in Venice, life might have been very different for him.
Six months would have made a difference. 5 years would have made a huge difference.
Hard work, it was just what the doctors felt was going to be bad for him. He was not to be deterred, and he went ahead.
When he said, "I cannot stop, I have to finish this piece before you take the knife to me," they said, "Well, all right, it's on your head."
First, Aschenbach finds Venice oppressive. It takes a while before he starts to feel liberated.
A stagnant smell from the lagoon, my temples throb, I cannot work. Oh, serenissima, be kind. Or I must leave, just as once I left before.
Britton not only had to complete the opera before his health gave out, he also wanted it to be his supreme gift to his partner Peter Peers, who was now in his 60s. Probably Peter's last great part, as he put it. For almost 30 years, Britton's relationship with him had been discreetly open, but illegal.
He's very aware that people are talking about him, and being gay was very, very a great problem for him. It wasn't to peers, I think, but it was always to him.
He struggled, I think, throughout his life with this tussle, in a way we don't need to nowadays, about being gay.
I just don't know how he did cope, you know, going out into the public, facing an audience of thousands of strange human beings and wondering if they're judging you.
At a time when some prominent gay men in the arts world were prosecuted, the police did arrive on Britain's doorstep, but took matters no further.
They were never overtly too close to each other in public.
They would no sooner kiss each other in public than fly. They were extremely respectable.
They hardly ever referred to each other publicly by their first names. It was always Peter Piers or Benjamin Britten.
We are awfully happy, Peter Piers and I.
In fact, Benjamin Britten writes for The Voice.
Jolly badly.
No, on the contrary, brilliant like that.
For example, a strange, strange time. My father remarried a rather bitter blue stocking woman who suspected that there was something fishy going on there. So one day she said to me, when I was housekeeping for Ben and Peter in London, I'd like to come and see you. So she came and said, now I want to see over the house. Right, so I showed her over the house, and right at the top of the house there was a large bedroom with a very large double bed in it. And who sleeps here? Well, and I told her the truth, and she was absolutely horrified. And I thought, what have I done? She's now going to go to the newspapers and there's going to be the most terrible row. She didn't, of course, because, well, it was all part of the family, so you couldn't quite do that.
There's no doubt that Ben was absolutely mesmerised by Peter's voice. And it was really a catalyst for so much.
I think it's marvellous singing. Absolutely marvellous singing. It's aiming at something so rare and so special and so pure that... No, I think, honestly, I think we're being absolutely... I think we've got two smashing takes there.
But I would like to have one more go.
Of course, Peter.
A thousand gleaming fires seemed kindling in the air.
Britten wrote for Piers's voice across almost 40 years.
Thousand silvery lights resounded far and near.
It was a partnership unique in the history of music.
The very breath I breathed was full of sparks.
The Snape Maltings Concert Hall was their baby. It was just 2 years old in 1969 when disaster struck.
Somebody actually whispered in my ear that the Maltings was on fire. So I rushed to my car and I rushed over to Snape. And halfway there, I could see a glow in the sky.
Panic stations, I said to Jack, for goodness sake, put your foot down as fast as you can.
And all my hair, the couch was reed by that celestial shard.
It was like a volcano going off. You had these curious mixed feelings about it, really. You were conscious of the fact that it was a terrible, terrible thing to be happening. There was our lovely concert hall being destroyed before our very eyes.
And while the wild earth echoing run to their strange minstrelsy.
But at the same time, you couldn't help but be terribly thrilled by it in a sort of macabre sort of way. There was something unprecedented. You knew that it was a historic event, and it was.
Mortal, let them die, let time and tears destroy.
We turned straight round and went back to Red House. And actually, Ben and Peter at that point didn't know.
Ben was extremely, of course, upset because the Maltings had become very dear to him, possibly the best acoustic of any concert hall in the kingdom.
Like a tomb, a desert's naked shore. To us in unimagined bloom, it brightens more and more.
The Aldborough Festival had just begun, and Britain's two-week schedule of performances in the Maltings seemed to be doomed.
There was a moment of shock where we thought, oh, we'd better go away and forget about it for a week or so, but as soon as one got over that, one realised that the first thing to do was to go on with the concerts and the operas as far as was possible.
At an emergency conference at the Red House, which lasted into the small hours, the composer turned administrator rearranged the whole festival.
The main reaction from him that night, he was already in his dressing gown and pyjamas, was to make plans for rescuing the festival. And he was completely calm, completely composed. There was no emotion, just determination.
It was so urgent that everybody just sat there absolutely aghast, taking notes furiously about what they all had to do.
It was only a year since his treatment for endocarditis. The hard-pressed composer inspected the ruins the next day with the man who'd designed the hall.
We met Britton and Pierce on the wet ashes, and I actually had a cry, and Britton said to me, I've had my cry, Derek, and I've got over it, because we'll build it again exactly as it was. And Peter said, well, just one or two little things, Ben.
The rebuilding of the festival and then the hall was taxing and tiring, but it symbolised the way Britton recharged his music after a rather arid period in the late 60s.
He got his mojo back, and basically something happened to him and he was able to move on, and I think this enthusiasm was there. It happens to composers. You suddenly get excited again.
The challenge was to rebuild the Maltings within a year and to raise the necessary money.
It does take up time, and one's life is a rather full one. I do plan my my writing very carefully. Now, with this big planning operation, the battle is already lost, I would say.
The first new opera for the rebuilt Maltings stage was to be Death in Venice, with a story fraught with danger. Britton understood all too well the infatuation that Aschenbach develops for a beautiful Polish boy, Taggio. Britton enhanced this idealized beauty by casting him in a non-singing role as a dancer. For Aschenbach, a widower with a daughter, this is not a tender parental feeling as in Curly River. He becomes torn between platonic admiration and a more sensual desire.
Taggio, the charming Taggio. That's what it was. That's what made it hard to leave. So be it. So be it.
Aschenbach has the chance to leave Venice, but instead succumbs to his infatuation, which he mistakenly thinks he can control.
Here will I stay, here dedicate my days to the sun, and Apollo himself.
Britton was attracted to young boys. And to dramatize that was something that he felt was a central part of his art.
Lots of composers would have stayed away from it. To confront it in a way is quite brave, I think.
quite awkward to talk about. But it's not at all awkward to play.
It was part of him that he was attracted in that way. It wasn't natural to Aschenbach. Aschenbach was turned by the vision of this boy, and his view of the world was changed. I don't think Ben's view of the world ever varied particularly as far as young men are concerned.
Taggio and his friends played sports on the beach, danced on stage as a Greek pentathlon, the games of Apollo. Britain's librettist Mfanwy Piper even suggested that the boys should compete like the ancient Greeks, naked. The composer said the idea was excellent and could be wonderfully beautiful as well as Hellenically evocative, but he was wise enough to reject it for fear of unwelcome publicity. In the event, Frederick Ashton's choreography was to cause a stir.
I honestly don't think you'd be allowed to put it on the stage these days. It was pyramids of barely adolescent boys wearing loincloths. You know, I mean, it was kind of... I know that it was certainly considered by some people to be deeply, deeply offensive and embarrassing at the time.
I personally wasn't bothered. I thought it was rather beautiful, and I had always admired Ashton's choreography.
Britain's librettist, Mfanwy Piper, wanted the boys dancing naked.
Oh, no, I didn't know that. Yes, well, perhaps just as well that she didn't get her way, isn't it? Really?
Britain said, I think it might be misconstrued.
Yes, I think we can all agree about that.
The Polish boy who in real life had caught the eye of the author, Thomas Mann, was only 11. In the book, he made Taggio 13, the age which always appealed to Britain. But in the opera, because he has to dance, Taggio usually looks more mature.
No idea, actually, how old Taggio is meant to be in the opera. Clearly, he seems to be around, say, 15 or 16 in that original production. There probably was a consciousness that he shouldn't appear to be too young.
I think it would be very difficult nowadays to compose an opera such as Death in Venice, just as it would be very difficult to write a novel like Lolita, for that matter. I mean, in a strange way, we've become more conservative, more politically correct, and all the rest of it now, than one could have been 30 years ago.
Even at the time, some of Britain's colleagues were nervous about the subject of the opera.
I was a bit puzzled and worried, in fact. I immediately saw a parallel to Britain's infatuation with David Hemmings in Venice at the time of the Turn of the Screw. And it seemed to me that this was a little bit too close to the bone.
David Hemmings was 12 when he created the role of Miles in The Turn of the Screw in 1954. Before the Venice premiere, he'd spent 2 months in Britain's house learning the part. The good-looking boy was, in a sense, Britain's Taggio almost 20 years before Death in Venice.
He just sort of drank in all this adulation that Ben was giving him. But if we can believe David Hemmings, and I do, it never got to anything improper, even though apparently they slept in the same bed sometimes.
My father told me, strangely enough, in Leicester Square men's lavatory, he told me that his words exactly, "You know he's a homo, don't you?" Now, I didn't understand, because I was about this big, I didn't understand what homo meant. But my father was therefore not concerned enough not to take the money that I earned from it, but he was concerned for my health. But I can unequivocally say he never endangered my health at all.
Some of us were amused by it, but we were none of us shocked, and we were none of us horrified, the way some parents might have been.
Peter Pears is quoted as saying, I had to take Ben, while in Venice, I had to take him away to cool him off a bit. Do you remember that?
Well, if you really want to know, Peter had to be taken away to be cooled off as much as anybody else. It was the same with the death in Venice, when Peter became totally besotted with the guy who was doing Tadzio. And he always laid his hair down much more than Ben did.
So
I think this cooling off business referred much more to Ben's frustration with David not really being able to hit the note, as it were, and that he wanted him to be perfect, and David was imperfect.
He was a dad to me. He really was not only a father, but a friend. And you couldn't have had a better father, nor a better friend.
Although there was this relationship with lots of young boys, never anything actually happened. I think it's very, and I know this from my own experience. I remember jumping into bed with him when he came on holiday on the Norfolk Broads for a couple of nights. We went sailing with him as well. But I can assure you, nothing happened. There was no inappropriate behaviour, as we would call it now.
Nothing happens in the opera either. In the book, Taggio brushes past Aschenbach, but Britten never lets them touch or even speak to each other. They merely exchange glances, and at one point the boy smiles at Aschenbach. And that is all. The rest is in Aschenbach's head.
There's a moment in which he actually encounters Tadzio, has an opportunity to say, you know, well done. Sees the boy and I just can't say what he wanted to say. I couldn't do it. I couldn't even speak to him. And at the end of that one, he then says, I love you. And then spends Act Two trying to work out what exactly he meant by the words, I love you.
Has a sort of almost a claustrophobia, Marlerian sound world, but something quite English and quite almost harking back to Peter Grimes. Stunning.
It's remarkably thinly scored. It's as though he can trust the power of the single line, of the single phrase, that it's enough.
Contrast of the darkness of the water, and then these little drops.
I think the tie between Aschenbach and Ben is extremely strong. And he associated with that character more than any of the other characters, even Peter Grimes.
But the way things turned out, boys were not Britten's greatest worry. In August 1972, his doctor called him in for a checkup. He needed emergency surgery on his heart, otherwise his life would be very short. But the opera was still far from complete. He decided to press on.
I remember him writing that second act when he really didn't think he was going to live to finish the opera. And he slashed everything out that he didn't feel was absolutely essential so that he didn't have to deal with anything that was not necessary. And I think that's why the second act, which is written at white heat, is so devastating, because it wasn't just Aschenbach's predicament, but also his own life or death predicament.
You have that strange story that Peter himself said, Ben is writing an evil opera, yes, and it's killing him.
An evil opera? I don't hear it as an evil opera.
An evil opera? Well,
what do you think he meant?
That's very good. That's really scary. I don't know.
It's a very telling remark.
I am perplexed by the use of the word evil, I must say. But it's killing him because he was working to a deadline.
That was compounded by the fact that this was an opera in which he was confronting his own demons, and that the effort of doing that intellectually was also taking it out of him.
Piers had always tolerated Britten's interest in adolescent boys. He himself was more detached, but he might well have felt unease at having to enact the struggle going on in his partner's head.
I think one has to remember that Peter was a much fresher, more outgoing character than Ben. And something as desperately dark as this subject would have worried him. And to have to spend weeks, months on this topic would have been hard, very hard for him.
But if Peter could get dressed up in drag and convince everybody that he was a madwoman in Curlew River, I thought he could get away with being Aschenbach in Death in Venice.
The white heat saw Britten through to the finish. The evil opera was done.
My father got a phone call. Ben rang him up, said, I've finished it, come and have a drink. So we went to the Red House Library and had a drink Christmas Eve, I think, or just before Christmas Eve, anyway, of 1972, and he was very pleased that he finished it.
After some weeks preparing the full score, Britten handed himself over to the doctors, 7 months late. He told his sister Beth, I'm going into hospital so they can find out what really is wrong. I promise to do exactly as they say. No one expects anything very serious or something that can't be coped with. He was 59. His cardiologist, Graham Haywood, arranged angiogram tests on his heart. The results were worse than expected.
I could see that the valve was extraordinarily leaky, which we knew anyway, but also that the pump function of the heart was seriously compromised. So that means that however successful valve surgery would be, the heart would not make a good recovery. So that I knew from the moment I'd done the test. It was knackered. Because it had become stretched over the passage of time, and I suspect particularly over the 4 years since the endocarditis.
So at that stage you felt that his days were numbered?
Oh yes, I didn't feel it, I knew it. We all knew it.
Did he know it?
It wasn't my job to explain it to him. That was Graham Hayward's job.
And did he?
I don't know. I rather doubt it, because otherwise the subsequent story would have been more palatable.
I don't recall anyone saying at the time that he was definitely not going to recover.
Then came the operation he'd so long put off to replace his heart valve, still quite a new form of surgery. Britten had told colleagues that after convalescence he should be as good as new, even conducting. The medical chaps, he went on, are optimistic about the future.
He wasn't happy, but he was quite accepting of what was going on. I said to him then, don't worry too much, we'll see this through together. And he always remembered that, you know, right up until when he was really very ill and dying, he said, You know, we'll see it through together, he used to say to me.
The surgeon described Britain's heart as enlarged, bulky and flabby, with all the extra muscle built up as it had struggled to compensate for the leaking valve. His assistant remembers it as like a prize fighter's heart. But the surgeon was puzzled by what he found. The cause of the valve damage is not clear to me, he wrote. It wasn't consistent with what he'd been led to expect. The heart valve had not been malformed from birth. When the heart weakness was first diagnosed, the specialist had wondered whether syphilis was to blame. But Britain's medical file is incomplete, and there's no definite evidence to prove or disprove the idea. It could rather have been the rare condition, Marfan's disease. Altogether, a series of conundrums about an operation that did not go to plan.
In the night, in the howling storm, has found out thy bed of crimson joy, and his dark secret love does thy life destroy. There's a touch of Liebestod there. It's very erotic, that music.
Oh, Rose, thou art sick. The invisible worm that flies in the night, in the howling storm.
The operation lasted the expected hour and 40 minutes. But there were serious problems once the new tissue valve had been sewn in.
At the end of the procedure, when you expect the heart to start up again into a nice, regular, rhythmic beating, it didn't do that. It got lots of extra beats and misbeats, and it was irregular.
What did that signify?
A potential for a cardiac arrest. So you keep the patient in theatre, watching, giving medication to see if it'll all settle down, which it did with time. But that delayed the return to the intensive care unit.
It then turned out that while he was in the operating theatre, he'd had a stroke.
We realised that he had some weakness in his right arm, because he could move it and do everything with it, but he didn't know where it was.
The anaesthetist remembers it as quite a bad stroke and says that when Britain came round, he was devastated. 10 days later, he was moved to the London clinic a few streets away to recuperate.
He was on a stretcher and I went to the lift just to say goodbye to him, and he said, come and see me. I said, yes, OK, I will. He said, come tonight. And I said, all right. And so I went to the London clinic, and he was very unhappy there, really. So...
Why?
Well, it, like when I was there that evening, the maid came in with his dinner on a big tray with big silver things on top. Well, he could hardly lift these, Valestia, and there was a steak, you know, a really thick steak, which even in his full health and strength, he wouldn't have eaten.
I suppose for the first 3 months or so, there was a lot of hope, but then it slowed down and slowed down, and then he started to go backwards.
This night, every night and all, fire and fleet and candlelight, and Christ receive thy soul. When
there wasn't that wonderful joie de vivre which one used to have. And I remember he said to me, you know, I sometimes wish I never had this operation.
He would often hold his right hand with his left hand.
And Christ receive thy soul.
And he would point with his left hand about something, and his right hand would be very still.
Every night and all.
One almost wonders what would have happened if he hadn't had the operation. Would he have had a few more years of a slightly better life? Or would he just drop dead? It's impossible to say.
For the first time since he was 5 years old, Britten couldn't write a note of music. 12 months after the operation, the anguish of his serenade 30 years before seemed all too real. He'd had to give up playing the piano, and things looked bleak.
At last, and Christ receive my soul.
There was terrible doubt as to whether he had it in him to write any more now.
Doubt from him? Or?
From him, yes, yes. I think he doubted that he was able to write anything of consequence from now on, because he just didn't feel that surge of energy in himself.
It was at this point that Colin Matthews visited Aldborough after some months away.
I was really shocked by how weak he looked and how ill.
In what way?
He was just very, very feeble. Found it quite difficult to communicate.
Britten's nurse at the Heart Hospital was persuaded to leave London and become his full-time carer, honouring her promise to see things through together.
I think everybody felt that this was the end, that he was just really dying. But I felt that there's more that could be done for him.
Straight after the operation, the doctors had realised the heart murmur was still there, though in the climate of 1970s medicine, they didn't tell anyone. Now they even contemplated a second operation.
Ian Tate and I thought, well, do we want to consider repeat surgery? But then that would be not likely to work because of the underlying flabby, weakened heart muscle.
So you did consider repeat surgery?
Yes, yes.
One option would have been to put in a mechanical heart valve to provide a better fit. That would have required blood-thinning treatment with warfarin, which doesn't mix well with some other drugs and with alcohol.
His cardiologist thought that he probably was a heavy drinker because he was in the arts, because he thought everybody in the arts was probably an alcoholic. But, of course, Ben wasn't.
He wasn't a heavy drinker, but he would have, as I understand it, spurts of really quite heavy alcohol consumption interspersed with very little alcohol consumption. That makes the warfarin levels very difficult to control.
But you could have told him, you can't drink anymore.
That's a bit unkind. Denying him one of life's pleasures.
See, they would ask Ben, do you drink? And he would say yes, because, of course, he did. But if he'd been told, you can't drink again, he would just not have drunk again. He wasn't in any ways addicted.
But did you discuss this possibility with him, with Britain?
Reoperation? No. No.
Why not?
Because we thought that the decision was self-evident, and because he'd already had a stroke from the previous operation, and it would have been unkind to burden him with a decision which was self-evidently in favour of leaving him as he was, because he was going to die of the weakened heart muscle, and another operation might have accelerated that. And in medicine in the early 70s, we were a bit more avuncular, and we didn't have to share everything with the patient.
And Christ receive thy soul.
Britain's medication was changed, and under Rita Thompson's care, he even began to compose again.
She was, I think, a breath of fresh air, and I think she cut through a lot of the sort of stiffness and reputation surrounding Britain.
I helped him bath and shave and get dressed and everything, because otherwise he would have had, all his energy would have gone in that. And then in the morning, from about 11 o'clock till 1, was his best time for working.
It seemed to be a sort of marriage made in heaven in some ways.
I think she changed their lives in a way and brought a lot of sunshine to the Red House.
Peter did actually want to say, we were talking about Rita, I think he said, Rita, well, Ben's going to marry her.
But that was just Peter being a bit dramatic, I think. Because it wasn't like that at all.
Rita had a creative as well as a nursing role. Word that Britain was depressed and couldn't compose had reached the Queen, who some years before had paid two visits to the Maltings. A letter arrived in her own hand asking Dear Ben to write something special for the Queen Mother's 75th birthday. Thanks to Rita, a birthday Hansel was the result, with words by Robert Burns.
He used to like, you know, someone to read aloud to him, and I used to read him Burns poems. He thought, well, as she's Scottish, that would be a good thing to do.
We will agree, and his leather wallet.
The title was Rita's idea too. The Scots word Hansel, meaning a good luck gift at harvest time.
He used to ask me sometimes about Scottish tunes.
We will agree, and his leather wallet.
And I would say, dee, 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 dee. He'd say, I can't take down deedles.
Feathers of a fleetwood feather, feather up his bonnet. Feathers of a fleetwood feather, 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 feather up his bonnet.
It's wonderful.
He sent off his manuscript and received a thank you letter from the Queen Mother, again in her own hand. What lovely things you've chosen for your lovely music, she wrote. I honestly do not think that anything in my life has given me greater pleasure than your birthday gift. He was summoned to Sandringham for a private Royal Command performance by Piers and the harpist Ossian Ellis.
We went there for Peter to sing and Ossian to play to the Queen Mother. And the Queen was there and Princess Margaret. He was sitting, of course, and at the end, Princess Margaret came over to talk to him, and he was trying to struggle to his feet. And she said, don't worry, and she sat, there was a little stool down beside him. She sat there so that he wouldn't have to stand up, which I thought was very kind and thoughtful. He enjoyed laughing, but, you know, it's from an ill man. You can't imagine that his mind was going like that all the time.
Britain himself never recovered any physical agility, but his late music never entirely lost the energy and quick wit that had defined him as a younger man. Take, for example, the medieval poem he found that poked fun at old age and death.
Whoa! Was he fun to be with?
No.
I always thought he was a bit like a tortoise.
I was a little uneasy in any case as a young, relatively inexperienced musician.
If you asked him anything awkward, he would withdraw. His head would go back into his shell.
You know, it only took a furrowed brow to make people tremble.
Like the woman who asked him, "What is the difference, Mr. Britton, between the Rape of Lucretia and Albert Herring?" Same notes, different order. In fury and rage.
He could be extremely cutting. If people didn't measure up to what he wanted, he could really demolish them with a put-down of a fairly savage nature.
I don't think that he took on friends just for the sake of friendship very much. I think there was always a very good reason why he befriended or got close to other people.
If you got too close to the flame, you were in danger of getting burnt. I saw what happened to people who did. This sort of respectful distance we kept from each other, which on my part was quite deliberate, brought me this wonderful gift at the end of his life.
Britton was now too weak to write any more operas. He simply couldn't reach the top of the manuscript paper. But in the cantata he wrote for Janet Baker, another story of infatuation, guilt and death, he seemed to be defying his illness.
Phaedra is a masterpiece.
Glorious beginning to that piece, radiant.
Really hits you between the eyes.
We were all blown away by it. I certainly was.
Phaedra, the wife of Theseus, the mythical founder of Athens, has become infatuated with her stepson, Hippolytus.
I saw his face turned white.
I was presented with this fantastic mini opera with the woman who was absolutely up my street.
Britton chose the version of the story by the French playwright Racine, in which Phaedra owns up to Hippolytus about her incestuous feelings.
Monster, you understood me too well. Why do you hang there, speechless, petrified, polite?
Thank you.
simply astonishes me that Ben can find this edgy passion of hers. Iciness of the strings, icy cold despair.
When Janet Baker went to Aldborough to run through the work with the composer, she hadn't seen him for almost a year and wasn't sure what to expect.
And he looked fragile. Then we started to work. We didn't work too long at a time, but nevertheless, this process was giving him life and energy and strength, and you could see that.
And I remember he was very impressed because she was word perfect.
And at one point in the score, Phaedra cries out to her nurse and says words which I found unsingable. Inoni, I want to die.
Oh, it's nothing not to live.
Oh, it's nothing not to live. Death to the unhappy is no catastrophe.
Death to the unhappy is no catastrophe.
When I first sang these words to him, it hit me like a bolt. What am I saying to this man? I felt that, I'm feeling it now as I'm saying it, how to give them the sort of agony he must have been through.
The strings take up her melody and turn it into something really quite ecstatic, an ecstatic acceptance of death, which is not just Britten writing about Phaedra, it's obviously him writing about himself. They rise and they break, like waves almost.
Somehow or other, he'd had to use this time of illness, as many people do. To come to terms with his life, with his death, with his work.
No words spoken about this?
No, not necessary.
My time's too short, Your Highness. It was I who lusted for your son with my hot eye. The flames of Aphrodite. Then Inoni's tears trouble my mind. She played upon my fears until her pleading caused me to declare I loved your son.
It is that this poor, broken figure, huddled in a wheelchair with a rug around his shoulders, can produce music of such incredible power and passion. It just beggars belief.
In her resolve to take her own life, Phaedra feels it's what she deserves.
Thank you. incredible, isn't it?
By this time, Peter Pears's last great part in Death in Venice was giving fresh life to his singing career, but no longer with Britten at the piano. It meant that just when Ben needed him most, Peter was away for weeks on end, a mouthpiece for Britten's music, but away nonetheless.
Ben absolutely adored Peter, was totally in love with him. Peter was slightly, not less in love, but his adventures were slightly more loose. I think we know that.
Ben was the monogamous one of that pair. Later on in life, Peter went pretty wild, but Ben was always absolutely straight down the same right path. And he didn't let anything deter him from this.
Was he aware that Peter was wild?
He was aware, but he said, I just don't want to know about it. Let him do what he wants to do, but just don't tell me about it.
But I do remember Peter getting a little bit anxious and cross at being quizzed rather a lot and being watched rather carefully.
By whom?
By Ben. Yeah. Just very occasionally. And I sometimes felt that Peter would even encourage a relationship with a woman just for the hell of it. It wasn't always very helpful, but it did happen a little bit.
Was he entirely loyal to Ben, do you think?
Yes, I think so. I believe so, whatever anybody else may think.
And I remember Ben saying to me when Peter was out of the room, because they'd been bantering, and then he sort of suddenly looked seriously at me, and he said, the world will never know how much I owe Peter. And I just always remember that.
Death in Venice was the grand finale of everything that Ben had written for Peter, the biggest gift he'd ever given him. Yes. Although, what a gloomy, what a dark gift.
Halfway through Act Two, I walked into the Maltings for the first orchestral rehearsal I attended, the first stage rehearsal, and I've never forgotten the memory of that moment.
Why?
Just an extraordinary blaze of sound. It's in the scene called The Chase.
Aschenbach is now so smitten with Taggio that he pursues the boy and his family into St. Mark's Cathedral, then through the square and the streets. He's losing his self-control and his dignity as his obsession becomes reckless.
Oh, voluptuous days! Oh, the joy I suffer, feverish chase, exquisite fear, the taste of knowledge, time gained by silence. What the echoing cries answer from the labyrinth. Follow them.
There's still no direct contact with Taggio, but Aschenbach has heard rumours of an outbreak of cholera in Venice, the dark side of beauty. In his frantic chase, with the gondolier's cries echoing down the canals, he resolves to shield Taggio and his family from the rumours and pursues them back to their hotel.
It still sends a shiver down my spine whenever I hear it.
Aschenbach even follows the boy upstairs.
Sunk in the bliss of madness. Ah, Taggio, Eros, charmer.
a crucial thing is Aschenbach's self-knowledge. That's what destroys him.
He wakes to find himself absolutely sickened and disgusted with himself, that he'd gone so low as to be stalking the boy to that extent. And I think this may have been a feeling of Ben's too.
I think he felt the underlying danger all the time. I mean, there's another part of his uneasiness. And he knew the dangers, and so he didn't venture into them. But clearly he felt guilt about this. It's very autobiographical, obviously. I mean, he examines himself and really rather condemns himself to death, because he's allowed, well, in the opera, he allows the relationship to go further than he should.
I think Aschenbach makes the decision that he deserves to die because he has had unworthy thoughts.
Gustav von Aschenbach! What is this path you have taken? What would your forebears say? Decent, stern men, in whose respectable name and under whose influence you, the artist, made the life of art into a service, a hero's life of struggle and abstinence.
Everything around him in Venice is fake, but Tadzio is something real, is something pure, is something beautiful.
Yes.
It's not about sex, it's not about paedophilia.
Eros has flourished too.
I think an opera is only worthwhile if it's dealing with a dangerous subject.
Art is art. Death in Venice is a masterpiece as a novella. The film is widely celebrated. I think that art transcends fashion. And, you know, the dilemmas it articulates about old age, about older men loving younger boys, or women for that matter. I mean, in a sense, this is a universal thing. They will be there forever, and great artists inform the way we think about them.
As Britain sat at home, too nervous to listen to more than a few minutes of the first performance on the radio, he could not have guessed that over the next 40 years, his newest offspring would have more than 500 performances in all six continents. Piers began its international journey by singing it in Venice itself, and then to great acclaim in New York. Britain wasn't well enough to go with him. Instead, he went with Rita to stay with friends in Germany. It was at this point he accepted he would effectively be an invalid for the rest of his life.
It was November and the weather was ghastly. It was grey and the clouds sort of right down on top of your head. And, you know, I think that was the time that he really realised or spoke about it, that, you know, that he wasn't going to improve. He was in a rather emotional state because, of course, Death in Venice was in the Met. Peter was having a wonderful time, wonderful reviews and everything there, and he couldn't be part of it, and he was missing Peter, and that was, I think, all of that made it was very lowering. But he was still working. He still did his work and wrote letters, wrote to Peter, and spoke on the telephone. He couldn't speak on the phone very much because sometimes he would just cry.
At the end of the trip, he wrote Piers an impassioned letter that reads as if it came at the start of their relationship, rather than after 35 years. He wrote things he couldn't say on the telephone, he said, without bursting into those silly tears. I do love you so terribly, and not only glorious you, but your singing. What have I done to deserve such a man to write for?
I have a friend was in the orchestra pit the first time Britain saw Death in Venice at Snape, and apparently during the Phaedrus monologue on that first night, my friend glanced over into the box and Britain was in floods of tears watching it.
And now, Phaedrus, I will go, but you stay here. And when your eyes no longer see me, then you go.
The love that went between them was so intense that it really hurt. It hurt badly a lot of the time. And I suspect that Death in Venice brought all that up, brought up a whole lifetime of very, very intense love between two people.
With the opera fully launched, Venice held Britain in thrall one more time for what was to be his final masterpiece. He was working on a new string quartet, his first for almost 30 years. He'd written four of its five movements when, in the autumn of 1975, friends suggested a trip to his favourite city.
Part of him wanted to go, part of him was frightened of going. And I remember in the drawing room, there's that copy of Death in Venice on the table, and he just pointed it to it. He said, "Look." And I said, "Oh, come on, don't be silly."
You were staying in the Danieli Hotel, which is in a very prominent position and overlooks the lagoon.
Best hotel. We had a suite, you know.
So he could rest in bed and work in a sitting room and be near, or Rita could be near him.
And I'd taken my sort of bell thing so that he could ring me, and it only would go about halfway to the middle of the sitting room. And you'd hear the bells. That's what he loved. You know, you hear one starts, one, bong, bong, and then all little bells start. And you hear all these bells. It's an amazing sound. And I think that's why he went to Venice, just to hear that.
That marvellous moment in Death in Venice, where the bells sound at the beginning of the church service, there they are.
He was working on a third quartet, and he had it with him, and that's what he was writing, the final piece.
He had a routine. He worked every day. He talked about it and was excited by it.
Certainly, he said that, you know, the opening of the movement was influenced by the bells of Santa Maria della Salute, which was built in the 17th century, after a plague. You can see the connection with Death in Venice there.
I remember talking about the smells and the sound of the water on the walls. Slapping, slapping, slapping sound.
We would decide where we would go to see the Caravaggio pictures or go to one of the churches. Then we went on vaporettas and things.
He walked all around the sort of back alleys and things, lifting his chair over the little bridges and so on, and had some fun, actually, spun him round.
When he came back, I saw this extraordinary music. With its great flow, it moves with this wonderful freedom.
Mm-hmm.
This is almost like Gregorian playing chart. It clearly influenced him. These notes are just one step away from each other. And the bass is using the same notes, but at a much slower speed. Again, we've got the feeling of water gently lapping.
In the old days, he would happily have played the piece through to himself on the piano. But now he had to ask the Matthews brothers to do it for him.
He asked us both to come and play it to him in duet.
Which was a little scaring because it was like giving a performance.
First, we made a rather lot of mistakes, so we stopped and had a little practice and then went back. And we got through to the wonderful ending, and there was a silence. And Britten said, "Do you think it's any good?" in a very small voice. We didn't know quite what to say, but we did say something to the effect that it was.
He wondered if it was the right length to go on a single side of an LP, which I think it just about worked out.
There was that stillness afterwards, because I looked round the library where we were playing and saw those paintings and all the evidence of this extraordinary culture, this high culture that Britten represented. And I remember thinking at that time, this has got to be preserved, this has got to carry on, and I've got to try to do something in my own way to try to keep this going, because it's so important. And I knew he wasn't going to live much longer. And yes, that was a very important moment of my life.
Britten, for me, was the key to sanity.
Why?
And I hung on to him because he could reinvent the simplest things, which seemed to me what a great composer does.
I've been influenced by him enormously, sometimes embarrassingly so.
I remember as a teenager, I really became absolutely fascinated with Britten's work, almost obsessed by it, actually, and listened to as much as I could.
Did people think you were odd?
I don't think so. I don't remember that. I probably thought I was a bit odd.
I think he is one of the great composers of the 20th century. I would put him alongside Stravinsky and Bartok.
Even those composers who perhaps don't feel that this is their aesthetic at all admire the way he could create music.
He will certainly last, and there's no question, I think, of that. I don't think that Britten will now ever go out of fashion.
The premiere of Britten's Third String Quartet was booked for December the 19th, 1976. In September, with the composer weaker by the day, the Amadeus String Quartet, led by Norbert Breinin, went to Suffolk to play it to him.
And, of course, everybody was terribly nervous about how he was going to be able to cope with an influx of these boys.
They didn't want anybody else to be there. So he said, "Don't worry about her," meaning me. "She's tone deaf," he said.
It was inspired by birdsong, birds he was hearing in his garden at Horam, where he'd moved to get away from the jets.
He dedicated it to Hans Keller, who then immediately wrote back and thought that the fingering for the first violin wasn't possible. And so he said to Norbert, "The fingering on this particular part, what do you think?" "Oh, perfect," said Norbert, "it's perfect." So he was terribly pleased about that.
But the man was half asleep a lot of the time. He was just so near to death. There was not much of him apparently there. And yet, every now and then, he'd make a remark which made you realize that he was totally and absolutely there with it.
the strings go up in natural harmonics. They all go up to their very highest note. And that's an extraordinary sound, unlike anything in any other piece by Britten, I think.
It's Fantasia on the key of C major, which is a key that was very close to him, particularly the end, where it's this extraordinarily translucent harmony.
They were going to come back later to work with him again, but by that time he was too ill. He said, just tell them they know it.
And if one thinks of the late quartets of Beethoven, for example, if one thinks of the Mozart Requiem, some of Schubert's late music, what composers do, and I think Ben did it, is that they draw into themselves more. And we, as an audience, are allowed to glimpse this mirror into the soul of the artist.
November the 17th. Ben is dying. The Gabrielli, his friends, are playing Schubert's early quartet in D major on the radio. He's slipping away from us, but if he could hear them playing this to him, if only he could carry this magic music with him on the journey, all would be well. Schubert, his God, would go with him.
Ich träumte von bunten Blumen, so wie sie wohl blühen im Mai.
Thing about Winterreiser is it's really a cycle of an old man, isn't it? I mean, an experienced man. And we decided that I wasn't going to be sufficiently of a tour until I was 50, I think.
Yes, we put it off because although Schubert was only 31, I think, wasn't it? Or was it 30 when he wrote it? One feels that it was the experience of a long lifetime and that we wanted to be equally mature. And
today is Ben's birthday. He is 63. I gave Peter Ben's birthday card, which he took indoors with a handful of others. We talked in the yard for a moment. He told me Ben had had a good night, was calm and peaceful, but further away from us. Ben had said to Peter, I'm going out like a lamb.
That was when he was so ill. He was in bed and having oxygen, and I was feeding him with his tea in the morning. And he looked up and he said, have you arranged a party for my birthday? I said, no. I said, I never dreamt that you would want a party. He said, well, yes, I do. I want a champagne party.
And I suppose there were about 8 of us downstairs drinking champagne and wishing him happy birthday. Peter seemed elated. He said that Ben was sitting up, drinking champagne with a bravura attitude. And he swung his arms and smiled, but it was an anxious smile.
Party's going on downstairs, and he and I are upstairs in the bedroom. And then he would say, well, I would like to see Mary, and I would go down and get Mary, and she would come up, and he would have something to say to her, and then he'd have a little rest. Now, I'd like to see Bill, or I'd like to see Pat, or...
Beth was openly tearful as she came down. It is, I suppose, the last time she will ever see him.
He said to people, you know, how much he loved them and how much they meant to him and things like that.
And Bill and Pat, much the same, but a bit happier. Happier, they said afterwards, to see him so peaceful, so calm, and perfectly compos mentis. Even asking about the Aubra Festival Club meeting.
And he had something to say to every one of them that was personal to them, and that was what he wanted. He'd obviously thought it all out. Leslie Brown, the bishop, used to come and see him, and at that last visit he had communion, and then Leslie Brown read the prayers for the dying, and, you know, Ben was quite accepting of that.
I saw him the day before he died. I think I went down specifically to say goodbye. And I was completely and absolutely tongue-tied.
That evening, December the 3rd, Rita asked Michael Petch to pay one final visit.
Could see that he was dying. And had all the features of somebody whose heart was about to give out. My most memorable part of the evening, apart from the patient himself, of course, was having supper with Peter Pears, which was an excellent meal. And we both drank well, but not excessively. And it was a very congenial evening. I would have thought that Ben would have enjoyed it too if he'd been in a position to do so.
Ben was really very low, and in fact, Mike, I suppose, was the last person he said anything to, because he didn't really need to say goodnight to Peter or I, because, you know, but because he was very polite and well brought up, when Mike said he was going to bed, he said, goodnight, Mike, you know.
Peter Pears was there, Rita was there, and I think by then the night nurse was there. And I went off and slept like a log. What I didn't know then was that he didn't speak any more after that.
We'd faced up to what was going to come a good deal earlier than this, and he was not in any terror of dying, and he died in my arms, in fact.
This kind of Marlerian ending with the vibraphone, of course, Tadzio, gradually rising up in register until the whole thing just fades out. It's absolutely sublime.
The final scene of Death in Venice finds Aschenbach in a deck chair, a passive victim of both cholera and his obsession. As he dies, he sees his nemesis, the untainted Taggio, walking out to sea, leading him on.
The last page of the piece transcends anything he ever wrote. I think it's magic.
Right at the very end, it's very precarious, but there's a trill underneath the music that leaves off only at the final bar. And the final bar is this pure A, a justification for this relationship, which has moved back into the realms of pure beauty and innocence.
In the boy's disappearance into the sunset, almost, with Aschenbach dead on the stage, there is this, an astonishingly redemptive moment.
There was a blackboard in the foyer of the Royal College of Music, and I was a 16-year-old. And I walked into the foyer and I just saw this announcement that Lord Britain, in fact, I wasn't even aware he was a Lord, and suddenly this was, and I just, it was always stayed with me, this image of seeing that he died, and I was terribly affected, although I didn't know much of the music. I remember being quite weepy about it. Endings. This is definitely somebody at the end of their life. So beautiful. It's almost unbearable.
Harmonics give you this very ethereal colour. And then it's as though we're ascending the very steps of heaven towards oblivion.
He himself, his spirit, seemed to have gone to another place, and the music was coming from there.
I still find it quite hard to listen to it. I find it's like sitting in a room with Ben saying to me, I know I'm dying, and I don't want to die, but this is a distillation of what I've learnt and what I want to say. And in a way, it's my farewell to the world.